Good morning.
Good morning.
Okay, now I remember to turn my mic on. That always helps. Glad to have you here this morning. It's good to see the sun out. Let's begin, as we always do, by speaking together our mission statement. Engage people, connect generations, build relationships in Christ. We engage people. We actively reach out. We don't just sit around waiting for things to happen. We work together and see great things happen as God works through us. We connect generations. All ages of people need to know Jesus. And it's about building relationships with each other and in Jesus. Several things we get started, but I'm going to have someone else besides me get started. I'd like to introduce you to this gentleman. His name is Brad Krueger. He's been a little busy as of late, but he's back.
Choke me up, I haven't even started. So, good morning. It is good to be back. Work has just had me traveling all over the place, so I haven't had a chance to be here. And I really, really miss it. I mean, this is where I draw my energy for the week. It fills me up. But I have been watching online. And I really, really wanted to say, you know, I watched last week's and when I get back, I said, well, I wanted to say that, you know, Pastor, you do a great job with the online service. I wanted to say that you're actually better looking in person, but it is a sin to lie in church. So we're just going to leave it at that. Great online services. That's right. So we've got a couple of great super duper fun things coming up here. Easter breakfast is... April 9th, and that falls on a Sunday this year, right?
It's always Sunday.
I love it here, isn't it? Just great. Ed McMahon. So we have two services on Easter Sunday, one of them early morning, which I don't go to, and then we have one later on. We have breakfast in between. So we're looking at doing pancakes, eggs, and sausage. So ladies, I don't need you to do anything. Okay? The men's group is going to roll up their sleeves and slink some hash for Jesus. Okay? So, guys, I need your help, please. I'm going to utilize, I don't know how to cook anything, believe it or not. My wife knows how to cook. But I had extensive military training in KP. So I will be doing all the dishes and things like that. But many hands make light work. I sent an email out to you, to all the men. If you didn't get this, let me get your email address so I can bother you in the future. But we're going to get together. We're probably going to have to come in on the 8th, get tables set up, get our battle plan together. And then on the 9th, we're going to get it all knocked out and have a whole bunch of fun there. So ladies, you gals are always rolling up your sleeves and making this just such a fun place to do. We thought, there's going to be one time where you don't have to do nothing. You can sit, okay? Duty roster. If you could, please check the back bulletin board there. We're a little light on the duty roster. I know everyone's got the winter blues. It's, thank God the sun is shining today, blue sky. Busy hands are happy hands. So signing up on the duty roster, we'll get that heart pumping and everything going. The other thing is stopped in yesterday and had a little meeting with Pastor and just going over different things, church financial, stuff like that. And I am absolutely overwhelmed at the generosity of this congregation. It is thank you for all that you do. And it's not just the treasure, it's the time and the talents as well. But really want to thank you for all that you do and all that you donate to Christ our Redeemer, so we can engage in our mission, with engaged people, connect generations, build relationships in Christ. We do have the giving box back there because we don't pass the plate, and you can also do it online. But thank you very much for all that. That's all I got, Pastor.
Okay, a few quick other things. Yeah, Brad's back. A few other quick things. Reminder, Wednesday evenings, we have a series of Lent dinners at 5:30. Lent services, devotional service at 6:30. The theme this week for the dinner is breakfast for dinner. So if you want to come up with something creative for that, that would be great. We've had really good turnout for this year. Anywhere from 25 to 40 people on a Wednesday night. That, for us, that's pretty good. So breakfast for dinner is the theme at 5:30. Then at 6:30, we're following the series Living Lent Proclaimed. You were in Bible class this morning. You got a little bit of a heads up on what that's all about. About the message we have to proclaim as people of God. Egg hunt. We're doing pretty good. We have the 10,000 eggs. We have about 6,000 of those eggs packed. We still have 4,000 to go if you'd like to help with that. The back room is available. We are in need of candy. I would say our packers may be eating the candy, but I would not make a lie like that, so I don't know. But we do need the little candies that can be packed in the eggs. If you don't want to bring candy, you could also simply provide cash or a check where it says egg candy at the bottom. That way we can get that part of it finished. The other big thing with that, we now have a sign-up sheet in back for Palm Sunday morning for the egg hunt itself. We're going to need lots of workers. Some of our normal ones, we often have our school staff that will come in. It's the middle of spring break. They will not be here. So we're going to need additional help on Palm Sunday morning with just some of the setup items. It takes a little while to get 10,000 eggs scattered out here in the lawn. So if you could sign up to help with that, that would be greatly appreciated. Last item I have. This week we begin Little Lambs enrollment. The early enrollment for church families starts tomorrow morning. Public enrollment begins next Monday, so and spaces go quickly. But Little Lambs enrollment for this upcoming school year starts tomorrow already. They had open houses the last week or so. So we're looking forward to getting Little Lambs full of students again. That's more than enough. All I have for now, I invite you to stand as we go to our Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, you've given us an incredible message to proclaim, and it's a message of your Spirit being active in our lives, that Jesus and his love for us gave his life, rose again, and it's a message we're called to take out. Help us to be active proclaimers during this Lenten season and always. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Opening song this morning is printed in your service folder. The entire service is also available on the screens. We start with Glory Be to Jesus. we take our personal brokenness, our weakness and our sin, we lay it at the foot of the cross and receive from there that forgiveness, that life, the freedom of being a child of God. Let's continue with the invocation. You'll see it both in your service folder and also here in front. In the name of God the Father.
Praise to our creating God.
In the name of his Son, Jesus.
Praise to our redeeming God.
In the name of God the Spirit.
Praise to our renewing God.
Let us join our thankful voices.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord.
You are the treasured people of God.
A people holy to the Lord our God.
Keep the words of the Lord in your heart. Teach them to your children.
Talk about them when you are at home and when you are away, when you lie down and when you rise.
We praise you, O Christ, as our good shepherd, for you willingly offered your life to save us. We realize it is because of our wanderings that it became necessary for you to sacrifice all on our behalf. Therefore, we come before you, confessing our sin and awaiting your word of hope and forgiveness. We have a moment of silence to consider our personal brokenness, but a Lord who comes to bring us the forgiveness we need. Holy and gracious God,
I confess that I have sinned against you, some of the sin I know, but some is known only to you. In the name of Jesus Christ, I ask forgiveness. Deliver and restore me, that I may rest in your peace. Renew me, that the desire of my heart may be to keep your commands, and the words and actions of my life may be holy through Jesus Christ.
Upon this, your confession, I announce the grace of God to all of you. Your sins are forgiven in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, as your forgiven children, we journey during this Lenten time towards the cross on which you showed us what true love is, and also towards an empty tomb where you prove to us that forgiveness and life are indeed ours. Help us to be messengers of this message of grace and love. We ask that in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen.
You may be seated as we turn our attention to the reading of God's Word. You'll find the lessons for today printed both in your service folder, and they're also available here in front.
The first lesson is written in Numbers 21, 4 through 9. Look up and live. They traveled from Mount Hor along the route to the Red Sea to go around Edom. But the people grew impatient on the way. They spoke against God and against Moses and said, "Why have you brought us out of Egypt to die in the wilderness? There's no bread, there's no water, and we detest this miserable food." Then the Lord sent venomous snakes among them. They bit the people and many Israelites died. The people came to Moses and said, "We sinned when we spoke against you, against the Lord and against you. Pray that the Lord will take the snakes away from us." So Moses prayed for the people. The Lord said to Moses, "Make a snake and put it on a pole. Anyone who is bitten can look at it and live." So Moses made a bronze snake and put it on a pole. Then when anyone was bitten by a snake and looked at the bronze snake, they lived. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle lesson is written in Ephesians 2, 4 through 10. But because of this, his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace that you have been saved, and God raised us up with Christ, and seated us with him in the heavenly realms of Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparability riches of his grace, expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves, but it is a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast. For we are God's handiwork, created in Christ Jesus to good works, which God has prepared in advance for all of us to do. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You are invited to stand as you're able for the reading of the gospel. The gospel reading for us today comes from John chapter 3, verses 1 through 21. Now there was a Pharisee, a man named Nicodemus, who was a member of the Jewish ruling council. He came to Jesus at night and said, "Rabbi, we know that you are a teacher who has come from God, for no one could perform the signs you are doing if God were not with him." Jesus replied, "Very truly I tell you, no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again." "How can someone be born when they are old?" Nicodemus asked. "Surely they cannot enter a second time into their mother's womb to be born." Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and the Spirit. Flesh gives birth to flesh, but the Spirit gives birth to spirit. You should not be surprised at my saying you must be born again. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit." "Well, how can this be?" Nicodemus asked. "You are Israel's teacher," said Jesus, "and do you not understand these things? Very truly I tell you, we speak of what we know, and we testify to what we have seen, but still you people do not accept our testimony. I have spoken to you of earthly things, and you do not believe. How then will you believe if I speak of heavenly things? No one has ever gone into heaven except the one who came from heaven, the Son of Man. Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes may have eternal life in him. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. This is the verdict. Light has come into the world, but people love darkness instead of light because their deeds were evil. Everyone who does evil hates the light and will not come into the light for fear that their deeds will be exposed. But whoever lives by truth comes into the light, so that it may be seen plainly what they have done has been done in the sight of God. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
We confess together our true Christian faith towards the Apostles' Creed. You will find this printed in your service folder and also available here in front.
I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting.
Amen. You may be seated as we prepare for the children's message by singing, "He's Got the Whole World in His Hands."
Thank you.
here this morning or right up front for this morning's children's message. Alrighty. Well, good morning, everyone. Now, when I was your age, there's something God did not gift me with, and it's doing this. What is happening here? They're painting. It's art and craft time. Now, I will admit, this is about as good as I can paint today. You know, painting has never been my gift. But I remember one time I had an art teacher who was lying through her teeth, who came up to me and said, "Oh, Steve, that's a masterpiece." I'm like, okay, I know Mom will be happy. But this is something I've never tried doing. I admire people who have the gifts and talents to do something. Yeah, they who have the ability to do sculpture work, who can create great things out of what seems like nowhere. And here's something else I've never been able to do. I've tried it a few times. How many of you have done this? Pottery. If I did it, it's an ashtray. But some people, and I know some of you, are really, really blessed with the ability to create something like this. This, in my mind, is a true masterpiece. Now, when God looks at you, he doesn't see a clay pot. He doesn't see a little painting. He sees something even much better. From Ephesians 2, we are God's work, created in Jesus to do good works, which God created or prepared in advance for us to do. In other words, God is molding and forming you to be a blessing, to do great things. Because when God looks at you, like I said, he doesn't just see a little painting, he doesn't see a little piece of pottery, he sees something even greater. He says, you are a masterpiece. He created you. He blesses you. You, in God's eyes, are beautiful. He created you to be a blessing. Now, sometimes we look like that three-year-old painting. Yeah. Maybe it's a little odd or a little bit different. But at the same point, you are a masterpiece. You are a gift from God that he blesses in so many ways. And that's something we can be thankful for and take great joy in, that you are a masterpiece. So let's go to our Lord together in prayer. And if you would all repeat after me. Heavenly Father.
Heavenly Father.
Thank you for creating us.
Thank you for creating us.
And calling us your masterpiece.
And calling us your masterpiece.
Walk with us every day.
Walk with us every day.
As we reflect that love you have given us.
As we reflect that love you have given us.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen.
All right, your children's church leader is in back. We will continue. We will continue with our next song, How Deep the Father's Love Goes.
He should give.
Let's go to our Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, in Jesus we have life and life to the full. As the wind of your Spirit blows within us, Lord, guide our steps. Help us to be messengers of faith, people who look forward with expectation to that day when we see you face to face and will no longer be on the outside looking in necessarily, but with you face to face. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. Brothers and sisters in Christ, if you are flying with young children, there's still a few airlines, depending on the airline and where you're going, that will require you to have a birth certificate for them. If you don't have an original, or more likely an authorized copy of it, the child may not be allowed to board the plane. That's fairly rare anymore, but it's still enforced in some places. A birth certificate like this is a form of identification. Now, a birth certificate is used primarily to define when and where you were born. But we don't need to have a birth certificate to prove that we're breathing and alive. Now, in John 3, this is kind of a tricky text. Jesus talks about being born again. He says we must be born again from above if we are to have life, if we're to see and be in the kingdom of God. Now sometimes, and here's where the challenge is, I think we get so focused on, okay, what does it mean to be born again, that we miss out on the wonderful life that God gives us when we are born again in His name. We can become so engulfed in trying to decipher born again that I'd compare it to this. It'd be like taking your birth certificate, framing it, putting it on a prominent wall just inside your front door, and then every time someone walks in, you stop them and say, "You have to look at my birth certificate to know that I'm alive." You see, it's missing the point. New birth gives us new life that you and I are living right now. Right now, as we're followers of Jesus. Because in Jesus, we have been given new life. That's what this is all about. Now, we take that new life that our Lord has given to us, we don't just sit on it. We nurture it. We feed it. I think we all get what it means to be born physically. But it's a lot more challenging for us to understand what it means to be born spiritual birth. In John chapter 3, Nicodemus, a very intelligent man, had some questions for Jesus. They're good ones. What does it mean to enter the kingdom of God? What is this spiritual new life, this birth from above that you're talking about, Jesus? I don't get it. Now, to understand where Nicodemus is coming from, I think we need to know just a little bit about who this Nicodemus was. Nicodemus is what we might call an insider. He was a Pharisee. He was one of the religious elite back in Jesus' day. The Pharisees spent all their time focusing on the law. But if you look close, they were rather hypocritical in following that law and the traditions they had come up with that were put together by the elders. To put it simply, the Pharisees believed that if you were good enough or religious enough, whatever that means, by following all the right rituals, all the right traditions, well, then you'd be seen as righteous, good in God's eyes. Now, Jesus spent a lot of his ministry going back and forth with the Pharisees. He wanted them to see, no, that's not how you get the gift of eternal life. It's not about what you do on the outside. It's about what God is working inside of you through the Holy Spirit. That's the major distinction. So Jesus has this conversation with Nicodemus in John chapter 3 about what it means to be born again. You know, something was going on inside Nicodemus's heart. He was asking himself, you know, I'm not sure that the way that I'm living and trying to get to God is going to get me where I want to be. I'd better double check with this great teacher, Jesus. He seems really wise. He does all of these miracles. But Nicodemus is a bit frightened. We hear that he comes to Jesus in the nighttime. He wasn't sure he wanted the rest of his Pharisee buddies to see him mingling and talking with Jesus. So he comes to Jesus with one goal. He wanted to justify his own actions about how he was going to work his way into the kingdom of God. But before he can do that, Jesus talks about this new birth. It leaves Nicodemus very confused about what Jesus is really talking about. So here's what we need to understand. Back in Jesus' day, to be born into the right family was a huge deal. When Jesus talked with the Pharisees later on, he even told them this, "And do not think you can say to yourselves, well, we have Abraham as our father." When Jesus talks about new birth, it is not about physical birth. He's talking about spiritual birth, birth in Him. Jesus is creating a new family. And the way you get there, it's not by the place you're born. Here's an example of this. Just because, let's say you were born in a garage. Just because you were born in a garage does not make you a car. Just because you were born into the family of Abraham does not immediately automatically check the box and say, okay, I'm righteous before God. That would come from outside of you. Instead, it comes from the way God works within you. It comes through His work of making you born again. Jesus says you are born again through water and the Spirit. Let me simplify that a bit. The Spirit of God is moving to create faith in our lives. Faith does not come, to be clear, by being hyper-religious, by being a really, really good, awesome person, although we're called to be that, or by following a bunch of rituals or man-made traditions. It comes when the Holy Spirit enters our life and works in our hearts. Now, as Lutherans, when we hear the phrase water and the Spirit, where do our thoughts immediately go? The baptism, exactly. In baptism, the Spirit of God is present because of God's promises in, with, and under the water, literally. Faith is created through baptism as God's Spirit works, even in the heart of a little child. Faith is a gift from God to us. I think that's often misunderstood. Because God's Spirit is present in baptism, faith can be created through it. So, and I've had this happen a few times. When someone comes up to me and says, "So are you born again?" My answer is, "Absolutely." Almost 54 years ago now, the Holy Spirit worked faith in my heart even as a child. My parents and my godparents, as well as the families in the churches in which I was raised back in Iowa, took that very seriously. They helped nurture and grow that faith. So let's not make this more complicated than it already is. To be born again from above simply means this. God, through the Holy Spirit, is working actively in our hearts. It's a gift from God to us. We can't gain it. We can't do it. We can't find it on our own. As Jesus says, and here's a great example of this. Think of the wind. The wind blows wherever it pleases. You hear its sound, but you cannot tell where it comes from or where it is going. So it is with everyone born of the Spirit. It's really a good illustration. Jesus was good at that. Now Nicodemus heard that and he was completely confused. How can this be? How does this happen? Jesus looks at him and goes, "Oh, really? You are Israel's teacher, and you do not understand these things. If I have told you earthly things and you do not believe, how will you believe when I tell you heavenly things?" For Nicodemus, to listen to God is much like you and me listening to Jesus in our quite interesting culture today, it's kind of risky at times. When Jesus teaches that he is going to blow the wind of his spirit into our nice, neat, organized piles, our structure in life, and it's going to mess them up from time to time. Here's what Nicodemus had done. He had put God into his nice, neat little religious box, his way of understanding God. And as long as inside that box it was okay, well, if I believe these things, if I live this way, if I believe all the right stuff, and I do all the right things within my box, I'm set. But the wind of Jesus blows very differently. It's not so much about what you and I do. It's about Jesus and what he does in your life, because it changes and radically transforms your life. Okay, so then how are we born again? Verses 14 and 15. And as Moses lifted up the serpent in the wilderness, so must the Son of Man be lifted up, that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. I think that's pretty straightforward. But there's one thing there that's interesting. That serpent in the wilderness, what's that all about? Back in Numbers 21, we heard that Moses had led God's people out of slavery in Egypt. Now they were out roaming around the desert, and they started complaining because they were thirsty. Moses, why did you take us out of Egypt so we could die of thirst in this awful wilderness? Well, God heard them, but he didn't send water. He sent poisonous snakes into the camp, and those who were bitten by the snakes died. The people realized we messed up. They came to Moses, please ask God to forgive us. So Moses cried out to God for relief for the people. The Lord then told Moses to take one of those vipers, wrap it around a pole, and raise it up in the air at the highest point of the camp. Make a snake. Anyone who is bitten can look up at it and live. Let's compare this to what happened with Jesus on the cross. Jesus said that in the very same way, the Son of Man must be lifted up on another pole, the pole of the cross. All who look at him in faith and believe will be saved. See, each of us is dealing with a real challenge in life. We've all been bitten by the snake called sin. If left to ourselves, that's a fatal bite. We cannot overcome it ourselves. Romans 3 reminds us, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. But Jesus came to take care of this. He would be raised up, lifted up on a cross. All who believe in him as his spirit works within us have eternal life. And then comes that very familiar verse. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. And don't forget verse 17. For God did not send his Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him. I'd also add, don't forget verse 18. It's a little hard to see here. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already. Because he has not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. You see, this story ultimately is not about condemnation. It's not about God's wrath. It's about how each of us, as God's Spirit works in us, finds life. Look up and live. The cross. Because it's there that you find life. And it's not just for those born into the right family. It's for the world. It's for you. It's for me. Wherever you find yourself today, the Lord invites you to listen to the wind of the Spirit, to look up at Jesus, and to believe and live. Your birth certificate as a child of God now says saved. But we don't spend all of our time looking at our birth certificate, do we? instead, we spend our time looking at the one who brings us life. We follow him, Jesus, our Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Now may the peace of God, which passes all of our human understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the true faith of our Lord Jesus. I invite you to stand as we take those things on our hearts and minds this morning to our Lord in prayer. Heavenly Father, the wind of your Spirit blows into our lives. Lord, help us not to resist that breeze, even if it messes up our nice ordered system and way of living, but to follow the leading of your Spirit, to seek you where you may be found, in the cross, in a tomb that's empty, and in your word which brings us the life and hope we need in Jesus. And Lord, hear us as we bring before you a number of things this day that are certainly on our minds and hearts. Lord, we pray you continue to be with Sarah Hermsmeyer and Matthew Hoffman, both of whom continue their struggle against cancer, with Anne McLean's mother and some health challenges she is facing, and with Joan Lyman and health issues that she continues to deal with. As the great physician, Lord, be the one that brings health and healing in due time, whatever that healing will look like. Heavenly Father, we pray for all those who are sick or who are hospitalized, who are dealing with ongoing treatment for cancer, depression, or facing substance abuse issues. We pray you'd be with the homeless, especially in this second winter that we are dealing with as your people here at Sandpoint. We ask that you would continue to bless caregivers who are making an amazing difference in the lives of those who are facing ongoing struggles. Lord, continue to walk among the people of Ukraine as they deal with a variety of challenges in the wartime that they are facing. Bring peace to that land in the midst of their struggle. We pray you'd also be with the people of Syria and Turkey as they deal with recovery from a series of earthquakes. Lord, help restore a sense of normalcy to their lives and be with them during this long period of recovery. And we bring before you Christ our Redeemer, our Little Lamb School, especially as we begin registration this week for the upcoming year. The preschool, the pre-kindergarten, the kindergarten there, the little ones, the staff, all those who work together to raise our young ones in the love and joy of Jesus. With our adult Bible classes, our children's church, and for the intentional outreach that we are making in this community and elsewhere, Lord, bless our work as your Spirit's wind blows new life into us as we connect people to Jesus. All these prayers we bring before you this morning, in Jesus' name. Amen. As Jesus gathered with his disciples in the upper room to celebrate the Passover, he was about to breathe new life into this ancient meal as they remembered how God had passed over the homes of those that had the blood on the doorposts. But now as Jesus shared this meal, the Passover meal, it became his meal, his supper, his body, his blood, given and shed for us to continue to celebrate to this day. As we prepare to receive it, let's join together in the prayer that our Lord has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, the same night in which he was betrayed, took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way also he took the cup after supper. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sin. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And the peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
You may may be seated as we receive this gift of our Lord's Supper together. As we're receiving it, we'll be singing My Faith Looks Up to Thee. Bob will take care of advancing the slides. We'll be ushered up one side at a time. Right side first. Bob will have the bread. I will have the wine. You can then leave your cup in the tray at the end. Let's receive this gift of our Lord's Supper.
Thank you.
remain seated as we go to our word of prayer. Heavenly Father, for this rich and amazing gift of your love, we give you our thanks and praise. Continue to walk with us each day as the wind of your Spirit blows within us to lead us where you would have us go. We thank you for that in Jesus' name. Amen. We receive the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. And the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Closing song, Come My Soul With Every Care. The chairs up in the front three rows. In the back, we still need to put them five to the side so our little lamb school can have this as a play area, among other things. Really, that's all I have this morning. So remember, God's Spirit blows in ways that we do not always understand. It works in us in ways we don't anticipate. Sometimes God's Spirit leads us to directions and things we never would have imagined. Kind of messes up our nice little piles. But still, just as God worked through Nicodemus, the Holy Spirit works through us to be his people. So as we depart, go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.